with the introductions of the course. The course Leadership Education was introduced by the Federal Government of Nigeria and approved by Nigeria University Commission. It has been the desire of the federal government to ensure that the Nigerian student, particularly in tertiary institutions of learning like university, polytechnic, and college educations, are given sound, qualitative, and comprehensive educations. As the name implies, leadership education, it is a course with two component parts, citizenship and education. Citizenship simply means the status or right accorded to the citizens, while citizenship implies the art of educating, discipline, schooling, and instructions. Education, on the other hand, is a psychonym for societal transformations. No society can develop without education. Therefore, citizenship education simply means the totality of learning, instructions, and schooling. Now we have two forms of education, the formal and informal. When we talk about formal education, it is a type of education that is taking place in the formal institutions like the school, colleges, or the university, where the curriculum are clearly defined with systematic approach to teaching. It is the opposite of informal education that takes place outside the school system. These are the type of educations we receive from our parents at home or within the society. It concerns with the moral, political, social, and economic aspects. Now, the relevance of education are as follows. The essence of citizenship education is to expose Nigerian students, particularly the freshers, in year one, to certain things they ought to know about the formation of Nigeria. Many students claim, or have known so many things about other countries of the world, but our socioeconomic and political issues in Nigeria, they do not know. Not to talk about the Nigeria as a social formation. They don't know how the Nigeria as a concept came from. These are things that ought to know about citizenship education. They're supposed to know the rights and obligations of Nigerians as citizens. They ought to know what government ought to have done for the citizens as obligations of government to the citizens. Through citizenship education, they're supposed to know the concept of democracy. They're supposed to know the constitutions, the operations of the constitutions, and the functions of constitutions. Is Nigeria operating federal or unitary, flexible or unitary? These are the things they ought to know about the country. As students of citizenship education, the essence of citizenship education is to promote political literacy among the Nigerian people. To know about the Nigerian people. Now, in Nigeria today, you discover that a lot of students find it difficult to know what and what they not to know about the course citizenship education. With the course citizenship education, it has exposed the Nigerian students to know the problems of Nigeria. The country is blessed with human, material, and natural resources, yet we cannot feed ourselves. What are the problems? Problems of leadership, problems of corruption, problems. So these are the things the course attempt to expose us and see how it can be addressed. The second lesson we need to discuss is the ideology of government. Ideology simply means an idea about a man and his environs. And the concept of ideology is associated with hedonia deteriorcy. Now, there are many concepts we need to understand about ideology as a concept. Number one, democracy. Democracy as a concept came from two Greek words. Demo means people, kratia means rule. It is the government of the people, by the people, and for the people, according to Abraham Lincoln. The concept of democracy was first discussed or coined by a Greek historian called Herodotus in the 5th century BC. There are two types of democracy. We have the classical democracy, or what you may call the direct democracy, and the neoclassical democracy, or what we call the indirect democracy, or the representative system of government. In the direct democracy, where it was first practiced among the great city, you discover that it is a system of government where only the adult male assemble themselves in a community town hall in polis in the great city state by the people called the Athenians to discuss issues affecting their community. Here, the slaves, the ex-convicts, women, children were not allowed to participate. It is only the adult male. Now, so many countries, particularly in African society, claim that they are practicing democracy because of the beautiful tenet of the system. And now, it is not possible for them to assemble themselves either in Abuja, which has been the Nigerian headquarters, or other centralized place. Against that backdrop, the country adopts what we call the indirect democracy, or what we may call the representative system of government, where we elect, where we nominate our representative to represent us in the House of Assembly. For a country to claim to be democratic, there are so many features or tenets. One of them is that there must be free and fair elections where citizens as voters are free to exercise their franchise, that is the right to vote and to be voted for without being victimized or harassed by political opponents. There must be freedom of associations, freedom of the press. The press acts as a mirror to carry out constructive criticism. There must be existence of opposition party to criticize the government of the day constructively. There must be rule of law, according to ABDC, to ensure that it is the law that is supreme and not the individual. It is the law that is supreme and not the voice of individual. There must be equality before the law, and the fundamental human rights of individuals must be guaranteed in terms of the right to life, right to education, right to fair hearing, right to property, right to education. These are some of the tenets of democracy. In addition to that, there must be separations of power so that the political power existing in the political system should not be concentrated or centralized in the group of persons or in the hands of group of persons or individual. If such powers are concentrated, it therefore means that the fundamental human right of individual will not be guaranteed, because such powers or group of persons will tend to be dictatorial, tyrannical, and of course, autocratic, and that will tend to violate the fundamental human rights of individuals. The second ideology we need to consider is the capitalism. Capitalism is an economic system. In capitalism, we are talking about a society where the private sector dominates the economy. It is the private sector that determines what to produce, how to produce, when to produce, in terms of productions, distributions, and production, distributions, and everything is determined by the interactions of the forces of demand and supply. Here, the government acts as a referee to monitor the activities of the economy. because majority of the sensitive sector are being controlled by the private sectors of the economy. A good example of such countries like the Britain, Japan, France, Americans. And we cannot discuss capitalism without Adam Smith, particularly in 1776. This is where we discover that those who are in charge of the productions, owners of the means of productions, distributions, and the exchange of goods and services are purely controlled by the bourgeoisie. The bourgeoisie owns all these and bring the services of the proletariat. The proletariat are used as the vassals or the workers. And if you discover, you discover that in most African society, they are tiddling toward the capitalist society where it is only the few that are controlling the economy at the detriment of the majority who are the poor, called the proletariat.